Thank you, Alan, I think. Let me repeat Alan's thanks to you for coming. It's tremendous of you to give your time. And what we're going to do is I'm just going to ask a few questions to you first, and then we're going to have a chance for everyone else to answer their questions, which is what we're going to spend the bulk of the time on. I think what I want to do first is, you know, Alan started with saying you sold aerials from the back of a van. There are not very many people who can say they did that first and are now multi-millionaires. What do you think it was that made you different from other people who sold aerials out the back of their van?
Well, first of all, I think the story gets a little distorted over the years, you know, about aerials out of a van, so to speak. I think it's more. I always tell young people that want to start in business, and what annoys me had annoyed me in the, I would say, the past 12 years or so ago, where there was this era of expectation that you would go with a business plan to a bank and walk out with millions and millions of pounds because you had some kind of crazy dot-com idea. And as we know, banks and financial institutions did support that type of stuff in those days, and it created a false atmosphere, a false environment for young people. And fortunately, in the demise of the financial situation at the moment and the crash, is that there is something good that's come out of it. And what's good that's come out of it is we're now getting back to young people understanding, like I did in 1968, which was 67, when it was a terrible depression and recession there, that if you want to start a business, you need to do it with your own money, and you need to do it, you know, with your own intelligence and brains, and with some backing of experience, right? So that's all it was, really. I used to work for someone else, and working for someone else ended up to be the chief cook and bottle washer for this someone else. And it dawned upon me that while I'm doing that for him, nice enough fella as he was, I can do it for myself, and took the risk at the time of taking, and this is the truth, £100 out of the savings account back in 1967, which I don't know what, being an economist, you can give a view on how much that would be worth.
Incorrect one, economist.
What that would be worth today. And bought a £50 minivan, second-hand minivan, and spent £8 on third-party insurance, and the balance of the money, I did then go and buy some car aerials. There you are. So it's a long way round.
I knew.
And started business one Monday morning, and that's it. And it went from there. Literally went from there. Because I came out of an electrical wholesaling company, and I'd attained some experience in where to buy merchandise, where to sell merchandise, and it kind of all went. It all went from there, and what I'm very encouraged with lately is that I've seen that some statistics now that young people, 17, 18, 20, whatever, are starting businesses from their bedrooms, so to speak, with some of their own money, small amounts of money, and growing it from there. Of course, the market has changed completely. You're now dealing in different things. You've got different vehicles by which you can sell stuff, eBay and all that type of stuff. But the principle is exactly the same. Start small, start in something that you understand, and you can grow into something. So, you know, it's not a unique thing. It's, it can be done with some determination and some experience.
Sometimes when I watch The Apprentice, you're sort of impatient with people who come with sort of wonkish ideas from book learning, as it were, and can't implement it at all. They're hopelessly impractical. Do you, you say in your book that you were amazed in the first series by how poor the academic candidate was in the academic who was in the first series was. And I just wondered whether you would advise young people even to bother a lot of the time with university, or do you think many people are going?
How can I put this in a way without kind of demoralising people? the youngsters these days have got it. They don't know how well off they are, so to speak, to be honest with you. And the problem is that in a lot of cases, there is no hunger. There is no desire. There is no desire for self-preservation, for becoming, to enable themselves to support themselves. And that's an era that I came out of. It wasn't, I'm not unique in that fact, but in those days, you know, we never had any expectancy that our parents were going to be able to support us or give us all these iPhones or Nike shoes and trainers and all that stuff, which are now a common day requisite for a youngster. You know, it's part and parcel of what you get. And I'm afraid to say we've got that kind of society out there of expectation. There's a lack of hunger. And there's also a situation where you kind of go to school, get your GCSEs, then maybe if you're brainy enough, you do your A-levels, then you go off to university. Of course, you've got every 1 year gap year, of course. You've got to go off to Australia and enjoy yourself for a year. Mustn't forget that. And then you come out of university and you hope for McKinley's to employ you as an analyst somewhere and all that type of stuff, right? Well, good if you can get it, you know. It's good if you can get it, but I think that what we're churning out is a load of people that really are either rather well off from affluent families somewhere, that have got their degrees, their 2-1s or their whatever they get, and they've got they've really got no job. They're not expert in anything. Now there is a section of people like that. On the other hand, there are people that go to university and become scientists and rocket scientists and doctors and whatever, or even economists that do contribute and will excel in their field. So there's a balance between whether you in needing in both. In my day, let me put it this way: you had to be very, very clever at the age of 16 or 17 to pass what we knew as A-levels then. I mean, really, really clever. And when you passed your A-levels then and you got 3 of them and they were with distinctions and you went to a university, you were a brain box. No question of it. Nowadays, with multiple choice answers and all this type of thing, anybody can pass them. I swear to God, if you sat me down with an A-level paper in maths, I will pass it. And I shouldn't be able to, because in my day there was no way that an average person would be able to pass a maths exam or a chemistry exam or a physics exam. Now the system has changed so much that you're churning out people that, frankly, in my opinion, don't deserve to be in a university, and therefore you're dragging down the level of educational standard coming out of university also. I don't know whether there's a higher level in certain universities which are sifted out and they are the real old-fashioned, true, traditional, real clever people, and they go to a certain section, or whether Oxford or Cambridge is sifting them out and all that type of stuff. I don't know. So I think your question was, is it worth going to university, or should I, if I've got a kind of an aptitude to do something else, should I forget that and do something else? It very much depends whether you're a lazy good-for-nothing or what, or whether you want your gap year and whether you want to conform and not actually go to work, or whether you really want to actually get a job, you know? It depends whether you have got ambition, and rather than expect it to be laid on a plate for you.
This sort of kind of get up and go and emphasis on self-sufficiency led you, I think, in the 1980s to be an admirer of some parts of what Margaret Thatcher had to say. And I just wonder what
I think she was an admirer of the type of people, my type of generation. I mean, let's face it, I was one of the things which has never really been recorded was I, in fact, was the first person coming out of the 1979 economic depression, just post Thatcher being appointed as the Conservatives coming back. My company was the first company to float on the London stock market. It was the first flotation in the new era of boosting the economy again, right? And it made a lot of headlines because it was this kid from Hackney that had suddenly floated a company for £8 million in those days, and Thatcher latched on to me she dragged me around everywhere, everywhere she went, as a prime example of the kind of culture that she wanted to create in the marketplace.
Because it's kind of all, I mean, you know,
she did, I think. You know, she broke the, apart from the things that people don't like her for, the unions and the coal miners and all that type of stuff, one of the things you need to like her for is the fact that she did break that kind of old boy, you know, Etonian syndrome in stock exchange and all that type of, as any of the elite were allowed in. Of course, the chirpy chappies came in and they were able to be traders and all that stuff. You opened the door to all of that.
But it's an unusual double to be an admirer of Margaret Thatcher, and also you've been you're an admirer of Gordon Brown's. And what was it you saw in him that you know that you admired?
Well, Gordon is let's put it this way. I was a Conservative supporter up until the Major era. Blair came along, and he was refreshing the New Labour, which I always called the Conservative Party in disguise, really. Because, I mean, effectively, if you look back on the manifesto of what they were offering, it was a businessman's dream, really, and it completely flew in the face of everything that the kind of prior administrations stood for. The mere fact that they used the terminology New Labour was quite clear what they were playing at. So I decided to support him and grew to work closely with Gordon Brown when he was the Chancellor. Mm-hmm. And so appreciation of him was built up while he was the Chancellor under the Blair administration.
And if Ed Miliband was in the boardroom of The Apprentice, what advice would you give him?
Well, yeah. He can go to a better surgeon to get his nose job done. I don't know really. I think we've got to. I mean, honestly, I'd like to duck that question. Is the most important thing.
And that's all right. You're allowed.
Yeah.
Okay, so I understand.
We'll take the Fifth Amendment on that one.
Okay. So before I'm opening it up to everyone, Just to tell us just how The Apprentice came about, because you're a business person. You hadn't done, I think, a huge amount of television. You were a publicly well-known figure. You'd been on the news and all those sort of things, but you hadn't done another television programme.
Well, I mean, the BBC came to me and said there's a programme in America that is hosted by Donald Trump that has been very successful. To make a long story short, they had acquired the what they call the format rights for the programme, and were doing and asked whether I would like to host the programme, and that was it. So I thought this is a very good opportunity to, because at that time already I was always doing a lot of work going round talking at schools and universities. I was a tremendous amount of stuff on the road there trying to instill enterprise into young people, which is I can't remember the thousands and thousands of people I've spoken to in the course of all that time, which included a lot of, on behalf of Gordon Brown, for example. We arranged visits to schools all over the country where I spoke. And this was, to me, was kind of allied to that. They wanted me to project, the government wanted me to project some kind of enterprise culture into young people. So I thought, well, this is a good opportunity. And I did it for that reason. And of course, you know, there's a certain amount of ego in it, as you can imagine, being on television. People like to be on television. I guess there was a bit of that in the beginning. But I did it because I think it encourages youngsters to go into business. And apart from all the humour and everything else out of it, the statistics, the BBC and other places show that there has been a great awareness of young people in business. I mean, you just pushed aside the theatre of it and the comedy of it, if you like. Yeah. The underlying messages that I'm able to put across are being absorbed elsewhere. And recently, in the last 3 years, I changed the format and adapted it to the economic climate, in the sense that I would change it from a job to offering someone an opportunity to go into a 50-50 partnership with me. So that format was changed 3 years ago.
Yeah.
The first winner of that particular format was this fellow Tom Pellerow, the inventor type chap. He's doing very well. His second year of trading is very is profitable. He's got all his products in Boots and Sainsbury's and Tesco's and all that stuff. And it's been very interesting watching it going. But the point is that looking in from the outside, as an outsider, it demonstrates what I was saying earlier on, that you don't have to start with £5 million of capital or £10 million of capital from someone. You can start small. £250,000 is not small to the average person, but in respect of starting up a business, it is. The other fellow, Ricky Martin, has started also, and he's now in his first year and it's profitable. So I'm hoping to demonstrate this, and you demonstrate it by proving that they're making money.
So who's the last thing before I open it up, the single best and single worst apprentice?
I'll have to decline answering that question.
That's okay. Good. Let's go. Let's have a question there.
You just mentioned Tom. Do you think that his success so far has been something to do connected with the fact that he was on your show?
There's no question of that. I mean, the fact that he's been able to get an audience with people like the buyers at Sainsbury's and Tesco's and all that stuff. The fact that he's associated with me, you know, will get him an audience with those people. So that it has been useful. Yeah, absolutely.
A similar way to Peter Jones and the source success.
Yeah, I mean, there's a bit of a funny story there, I think, which saucy story, so to speak. I don't think that actually went as well as people would like you to believe, or the BBC would like you to believe. I think the truth of the matter is he got legged over in the end. And it's got nothing to do with him anymore.
If you would give up your day job, and if the Labour Party won the next election and made you Prime Minister, what would you do to get this country back on its feet and help the...
Yeah, I mean, I've spent the last 3 years, or 3 or 4 years, as a Lord in the House of Lords, and I've understood what I've learnt there is that there are some very, very clever people in there. Very, very clever people in there that come from all different walks of life. The House of Lords is made up of people who are expert in the law, in education, in business, in foreign affairs, and all this type of stuff. Okay, and they've spent years in there, and that's what they're doing in the House of Lords, which is a kind of brings me round to saying that you need to spend your whole life in politics to understand how to run a country. You can't just take a bloke like Lord Sugar and say, Cor, you're quite a sensible fella, go on, you take over the country, because I wouldn't know where to start, to be perfectly frank with you, right? It's like asking me to go into the operating theatre at Great Ormond Street and can conduct brain surgery on a three-year-old child. That's the kind of analogy that I would make to it. I would not know where to start. One has to have an upbringing through politics, and I don't just mean learning how to lie. I mean learning.
So that's quite interesting, because a lot of people often say, "Oh, you know, you need people who've experienced the real world," and actually, you're kind of saying it's the opposite.
You do need people that experience the real world, but in sections, for example, they appointed me as an advisor for business. Correct appointment, right? When you look at that idiot, Vince Cable. He has got no clue whatsoever, and he has had the title of the business minister. Not a clue whatsoever. Not a clue. He's been, no disrespect in this, he's been an economist all of his life.
My economist's background is like your aerials, incidentally. Okay. It's grown in the telly. Right. So.
he's not been on the coal face. He's not run a business. He's not, what I would say, loaded the lorries, sold the stuff, made the stuff, been on the production line, and really understand what goes on the shop floor. And yet he has the title of the business secretary. But I would say that the Prime Minister's job is a tough one. It's something which you wouldn't know where to start, really. And I think, I certainly wouldn't know how to do it.
Okay, gentleman there, that row, two rows back.
I think in America, one of the reasons why you've got a large sort of increase in small startups becoming successful, sort of like your Googles, your Apples, everything over the past 20, 30 years, is that there's a culture there where it's all right to fail.
Mm-hmm.
And every sort of successful entrepreneur has two or three failures until they have that big business idea.
Mm.
What do you think could be done here in the UK to shift that culture towards that?
It's true. I mean, as long as failure is not fraudulent, so to speak, and it is genuine. I had a go, I had a chance, and I went chapter 11. It's true that you can learn from failure. There's no question of it. I think failure is frowned upon a little bit in this country, and it is that you're absolutely right. There is a kind of you're not, you know, frowned upon if you start again. And there are some great examples of billionaires that are in America that have, you know, have faltered in the startup stages, you know. I don't know, it's English, it's an English culture. I don't know, it's something that if you fail, that there's a kind of a stigma attached to it, and it's difficult to get going again. It fascinates me that the banks, for example, they're open for business in America. Normally, they're open for business. They're the greatest people of talking themselves up. I mean, I just came back after a 3-month stint in America, and it is amazing to listen to that. They're very good at talking themselves out of trouble, and it creates a much better atmosphere. And having watched, looking at the news, the general news, when you wake up in the morning and the general demeanor of people, they are trying to talk themselves out of trouble. Whereas here, you know, you've got the Daily Mail, where you want to slit your throat by the time you get to the third page every day. Right, every single day, it's doom and gloom, and that's what they write. That's the culture of this country. It's doom and gloom, and the news reporting here is doom and gloom. But America, you're right. How did change it? I don't know. Get rid of the Daily Mail, I think, is a good start. Good starting point. I would anyway.
Good. There was a question down there.
Lord Sugar, Daniel as well. I used to work for a chap called Jack Etchie, who I think is one of the great entrepreneurs and social entrepreneurs of the last 50 years.
Mm-hmm.
Mr. Petchy used to say, you can't teach leadership. Either you're a leader or you're not a leader.
Yeah.
Do you think that's true? And if so, or if not, what advice would you give to the young guys from UGS here today who are about to...
Yeah, well, I think Jack is absolutely right. I'll take it a stage further, is you can't teach so-called entrepreneurialism, right? I mean, it annoys me when I go and discuss sometimes in front of a young audience where people jump up and ask me questions, and some young fellow jump up and tell me I'm an entrepreneur. That winds me up straight away, because I say to him that, you know, an entrepreneur is an expression which someone else calls you. You don't call yourself that. It's something where, you know, you have done something to deserve that title. And I also explain to people, the most frequently asked question of me is, how do you become an entrepreneur? And I tell them, you can't go to Boots and buy a bottle of entrepreneur juice. Neither can you go to WH Smith's and buy a book. It's in you here somewhere, okay? And I always put it down, form an analogy of, lock me in a room with a piano teacher. And yes, I guess I would come out after a year and be able to do a little rendition of Roll Out the Barrel on the piano. Would I ever be a concert pianist? Not in a million years. Never. Not in a million years, because that concert pianist has a talent somewhere that you can't explain. And it's the same with entrepreneurial spirit. It's something that is there, something that's inside you, and it's, oh, you either got it or you haven't. And you've either got leadership skills or you haven't. And that's it. You can't make something. You can't make someone into a leader if they don't have those skills. What you can do is to recognise that there's potential there, and perhaps advise on how to enhance that potential.
Okay.
Daniel, you as well, having seen several leaders over the...
He thinks I'm right.
Yes, actually, it's certainly true in politics, which is the field I. that, you know, watch, that people have natural abilities in politics and you can't really teach people how to do it. And an awful lot of times people are taught how to perform on television and you're nervous and you're either a natural at it or you can't do it. And
like Hilary DeVay, you mean?
Sorry, yeah.
She's That's created like, a new category of the BAFTA Awards of the horror series on it.
I can tell.
I wonder about your view on internships as a way to try and
get internships
to get students into companies so they've got the brains, give them some practical experience and hopefully help them.
And there's a whole thing about paid internships, you know.
Yeah, I mean, that's a big subject, a tremendously big subject. And, you know, here is a kind of a bit of a wake-up call to this stuff, you know. I mean, With the enterprise initiatives in the Labour Party that I looked at when I was one of the advisors there, there was always talk of young people coming into businesses and learning and all that type of stuff. And, you know, in the traditional way that an apprentice did in the old-fashioned engineering terms, which have gone long gone, but Rolls-Royce will claim it's not, but they're about one of the only examples, or the motor companies, the engineering companies, where you can actually be an apprentice and stand by the side of a craftsman and learn your trade. That is, you know, kind of long gone, really, with certain exceptions. One of the problems with bringing someone in is that if you're running a tight ship business, for every greenhorn that you bring in, you need a qualified person looking over their shoulder. And therefore, that person is distracted from doing the job that you're paying them for. And so it's a cost to the company. There is no question of it. And you have to wake up to that. You cannot, I've seen it in my companies in the past in Amstrad where, you know, kids came, wanted to come in during the summer and they loved electronics, they loved computers, they loved this, they loved that and all that. So yeah, come in. And the problem is that they come in and then it's, we better give them something to do. And it's that giving them something to do, to train them, distracts a whole group of people away from the main core of your activity. So what you can argue, and what I've always argued is this, is that some of these initiatives that are there, or which are government driven about training people, and we taxpayers paying for it, you would be shocked at the amount of money that is spent on training people in so-called independent companies that are set up with the sole purpose of training young people on behalf and sending a bill to the government, kind of contracted out stuff. If you took that total amount of money that is spent on training young people and turned it the other way around and paid it to companies, paid a company to employ somebody and therefore they're getting some money to train somebody, I think you'd have a much better result. But to ask them to do it for nothing and pay the person also, especially in these economic times, is difficult. So I think the government, if I, this gentleman asked one of the things what I would do, it sounds very simple in me just logically stating it, but I would just immediately cut all of those billions, absolute billions that are spent in these so-called training places, which employ, incidentally, thousands and thousands of jobs worth that are not experts, they claim they are, and take that money and say, right, you employer, you Mr. Google, or you Mr. Amscreen, or you Mr. you know, Viglan, you employ a kid or young person and we will pay you £10,000 a year, which, you know, and we'll also pay the kid £5,000 a year or something like that, and you train them, and that's the way you can get it done. But because you've got to get the company's attention to do it. And the company are running tight ships. They can't afford A, to pay people, and B, to have their key staff distracted.
Yeah.
A slightly different question, of two parts, I hope. So during my gap year, I typically spent time in Israel, as a good Jewish student should. And while I was
not Australia then.
No.
Oh, okay. Well, we're different then.
I visited a high-tech firm called NDS.
I know NDS. Yeah.
So my question is two-part. How have you, in your business life, interacted with Israeli companies? And do you see it as an important part of
business? NDS were a great company. I've done a lot of business with them. Yeah, yeah. And they are a Murdoch company, right? They were bought by Murdoch because there's a man who's got some vision, and he picked the security for the set-top boxes, right? And yeah, they did very well. Abe, what's his face? I forgot his Pellet. Yeah, Abe Pellet. Yeah, so yeah, there are some great, I think they're one of the great success stories in Israel of technology. The only problem I've ever had, and I used to say to my fellows, you know, come on, these Israelis, they're very, very good. They're very good on this, all this electronics and technology stuff. And get out there and go and see what you can do, what they've got. The trouble is they're Jewish also. And the trouble is that the big, big trouble is that you know, is that they won't listen. They won't listen and say, I'll start off backing you in a certain way. They wanted too much up front. Every single opportunity that we looked at was, they were too focused on a contract and terms, onerous terms in contracts and all this type of stuff. And they still had nothing. They had nothing to talk about yet. And it was more focus on the business and let's get it going. And don't worry, we'll look after you. It will be okay. We've not been able to do any business with Israelis on that stuff because they're a little bit difficult in contractual in contractual things. And I think that's their downfall. Some that's why I don't think why I think, for example, the Chinese and the Koreans, who have got who have been so successful in the implementation of mobile phone design and manufacturing, have got on so well, you know, and the Israelis, I think they need a bit of a lesson in realizing that they've got to drop their standards initially or their expectations and listen to the outside world, let them get, you know, and let someone advise them what to do and don't think they're going to be legged over all the time. That's my experience, anyway.
Somewhere over there.
Hi, I wanted to be cheeky and ask two questions, if that's all right. Who is your role model and why? And have you had a career setback and how did you get through it?
That's four questions.
I think that, you know, in life you tend to have a variable role models, you know. When we spoke earlier about me starting in the back of my van, you know, the role model in my family was my uncle because he was the only one in the whole of the family that had a shop. And so he was the businessman that one looked up to. And of course, as one overtook his kind of status of his enterprise, the next role model would have been one of the manufacturers that I was either buying from or in awe of and looking up to, and it just grows with you. I always think Arnold Weinstock was one that I was very, you know, I admired a lot, and obviously Rupert Murdoch, who I mentioned earlier on, is someone who I admire a lot. So, you know, variable role models, really, yeah. Setbacks, I mean, in business, you have setbacks all the time. I've always said that, you know, I've won more than I've lost. But and I'll tell some people sometimes that I hope that in some businesses, I hope that, and I wish that they would make in their lifetime, in the whole of their lifetime, what I've lost on certain individual deals, you know. But it puts it in perspective, you know. And you just have to pick yourself up and move on, really, yeah?
I actually wanted to stay on the point of you either have leadership or you don't.
Mm-hmm.
You obviously mentioned you know, kids getting iPhones as a given, and a gap year, it's not something that you doubt, you just do, and as things that don't encourage hunger. So I'm wondering...
Don't encourage what?
Hunger.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm wondering, what would you recommend? I understand that, you know, you either...
It's difficult. There's this peer pressure, isn't there? You know, if you go... I mean, the point is that we live in a society... we live in a society now where we are not hard up, I'm pleased to say, in one respect. Homes, two-car homes, microwaves, fridges, washing machines, and all this stuff, alien to the 50 years ago, completely alien. And so there's an expectation of the youngsters that grow up. And they go to school, they see someone else wearing a pair of Nike trainers, they don't want an Asda pair of trainers. They want the Nike trainers. They've got an iPhone, they don't want an old Nokia thing, they want an iPhone, and they put the pressure on the parents, and the parents are just as bad as the children themselves, in that that's what their goal in life is, to provide for their children, to keep them up to scratch with what the children's expectations are. And there are some, I suppose, sensible parents that set goals and targets, you know, pass your exam, do this, clean your room, whatever, I don't know, and you'll get one of those things, but most of the time they get them anyway. And I'm afraid we're in that rut. Now, I don't talk, I suppose, if someone up in the north of England, in Middlesbrough, sat here listening to me, they'd want to tear my head off and tell me that, you know, you walk through the streets of Middlesbrough or walk through the streets of Barnsley or something like that, you don't know what you're talking about, you're living in a different planet, blah, 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 and all that type of stuff. Of course, there are, you know, there's poor communities, but overall, it's not like it was 50 years ago. Overall, the criteria of what a married couple do when have their children now, they look after their children, they work for their children, they make sure their children are provided for, and that, I'm afraid, has, I say afraid, that has an effect on a lack of hunger culture, really.
So is there anything, sorry, last thing, is there anything that you think can be done, either by, most importantly, the parents or the educational system to encourage that hunger still? Because...
The only thing that creates that is that if you get into a real horrible, nasty, dire depression where, you know, wages, salaries, ownership, things that you're capable of doing go away, and then you start to value the fact that you're wanting it again, you have to get it yourself. But I don't think there's any kind of magic wand that one can wave, really. I think, you know, I do put it down, it's the parents' fault. Simple as that.
Gentleman back there. I'll come back to you, sorry. I want to bring her up, but I'll also come back to you.
Hi, Lord Sugar. You talk about the sense of entitlement of young people, and as the father of a 12-year-old who never gets off her iPhone, I have some insight into that. But I'd be interested to know what you feel about the sense of entitlement of your own peer group, some business leaders who believe that success or failure, or even bringing the global economy to the brink of collapse, still entitles them to the most massive rewards.
Well, first of all, I won't take exception to the fact that you've categorised me with these people.
I said some business leaders.
Yeah, some.
They are your peer group, though. I mean, I'm not casting aspersions.
The ones that have brought the economy to the knees have been the banks, so to speak, right, by overtrading, yeah? And if you're referring to the banks that overtraded in 2007 and 2008 onwards, yes. I mean, you know, it was a culture that came from the United States of America. They all started playing with money that they didn't have, right? And they got paid bonuses and all that type of stuff, and then the bubble burst. And there's so many, you know, after the event know-it-alls now that say, well, I saw it coming, and he might have been one of them. I saw it coming and I knew it couldn't happen, and all that type of thing. But the hardcore businesses that are still here, the Tesco's, the Sainsbury's, the, you know, of this world, the, you know, the Philip Greens, if you like, and the Bransons of this world, they didn't cause these issues. They're working through them. They're trading through them. So I'm not quite sure who you're referring to, but you know, it's like any thief, for example, or any fraudster, right? If you're trading in something which is not real, yeah, they should be punished somewhere or another. It was just they were legally dealing in a Mickey Mouse world, and I don't know who's employing them now and paying them bonuses and all this type of stuff, but I do know that. If you incentivize somebody and you say, look, the bank's in trouble, we're losing $2 billion a year, kind of come in and run it, someone's got to run it, and cull that $2 billion down to $100 million, like it or not, that person that does it is entitled to a bonus for doing it, for achieving it. You're a trader sitting on the floor in Morgan Grenville or something like that, or in one of the big trading houses, Goldman Sachs and all that, and they've given you a seat, they've given you a computer in front of you, they've given you a telephone, and they've given you some parameters in which you work, which they're prepared to gamble on you, and you make them £5 million in a day due to your instincts in the marketplace, and they give you £1 million. Is that all right or not? I'll tell you what, it'd be all right with me. If someone made me £5 million a day, I'd give him £1 million. That, you know, I'm afraid that's how it is. Have you ever thought how Goldman Sachs have got turn in every quarter and they say they've got billions of pounds of profits? It's all from these type of blokes that I'm referring to sitting throughout the world, doing this trading for them. Is it right to trade on shares and talk shares down and talk shares up and all that type of stuff? Is it right? No, it's not, I suppose. Is it fair? No, it's not. But that's the market that's been created. It's the same in the currency market. The movement in currencies and they trade. So, yeah. And that, I'm afraid, is one of the problems we've got with youngsters also. They want to go and want to be one of them Goldman Sachs traders. And, of course, they don't realise that they've got to be a little bit, they've got to have a bit of brain in them to do it, yeah.
Right, far end. There's a gentleman over there.
Yeah.
Back there, because you've had one already, I think. Sorry.
Lord Sugar, as a Spurs fan, I spend most of my nights worrying about whether Daniel Levy's going to persuade Gareth Bale to stay over the summer. So using that as an analogy, how do you manage to motivate your people, keep your best people? What are your tips for managing people?
It is a bad analogy. Football is a terrible analogy. You can't logically convince a football player, motivated by an agent, or stimulated by an agent to do anything, to be honest, because there's no such thing as logic in that industry. But generally, people that stay with you are motivated not necessarily just by money, but they're motivated by the enjoyment or the excitement of what you're creating, and the fact that you make them part of a team, you know, and that they can see that they're actually achieving something towards the goal of the organisation. And I think if you ostracise people or you don't show them your appreciation in that way, then you can expect them not to show that loyalty.
What did you think of AVB in his season?
That's about the fourth question I'm going to duck today.
Are you confident now you're going to make the Champions League? Because we talked about it before and I said
Fifth question.
I said it was a 39% chance, yeah. And you thought that was too
high. Yeah, I'm, you know, having done lots of these Q&As and all this type of thing, and I'm sure there's no nasty Daily Mail journalists in your audience here, but I do have to be very careful sometimes on what I say, because people, you know, report it the next day in the national newspaper completely out of context.
Yeah, I'm sorry.
And of course, we're recording the whole of this thing, are we not? For those papers, the people that may have smuggled them away in. Yeah.
I find it really hard to reconcile.
Can work, just wait for the...
I find it really hard to reconcile what you've just said about a lack of hunger amongst the younger generation, but also making sure that staff are engaged. You know, when I left university, it took me a good 5 years to really find a job that I felt valued at, that I enjoyed, and actually...
You need to look in the mirror, maybe. I don't know. I don't know your circumstances. I can't, you know, delve into your circumstances as to why and where you looked and what your skills are. I don't know, you know.
But on this specific point you were saying, you know, that you've got to engage...
I mean, the point is, you didn't have that amount of hunger that you needed to actually, I'll take a job working for London Transport initially and sweeping the platform at the underground just to get a bit of money up to get me going, would you? You said, that's not for me. Oh, no. I don't sweep floors. Well, that's what it was like 50 years ago, you know. If you had aspirations and wanted to be something, you couldn't get a job, but you had to go and support yourself, you know. What did you do in those few years that you couldn't get a job? Who supported you?
I was working for 5 years, but I didn't enjoy what I was doing. I hated it.
Is that my problem? Right? I mean, what do you want me to say? It's more for you, no?
No, not at all.
You may have enjoyed sweeping the floor better then.
Not at all. I just thought what you'd said was contradictory, that was all.
Good. I don't think anyone else is going to try saying that. Yes, there's a gentleman here. Thank you.
What did you want to do when you were very young? And what do you think you'd be doing now if you didn't sell car aerials at the beginning?
You know, as a kid at school, you aspire to do certain things. I personally excelled in sciences at school, chemistry and physics and maths. And I had aspirations, and I used to do Saturday jobs. In one particular case, I had a Saturday job in a pharmacy, a very nice fellow. Very nice man, and you know, I aspired to perhaps become a pharmacist and all that type of stuff. And it was in those days, I mean, I go back to what the point I was making earlier on. This was not a multiple question type qualification thing. To become a pharmacist was a massive task of learning, of education, of going and all that and all that stuff, as it was to be a doctor, as it was anything else. And so I had. That was one of the things that I wanted to do, but having had a reality check in the onerous amount of work that would have to be done in order to achieve that, I realised that I couldn't do it. One, because there was no financial backing to do it, and two, maybe because perhaps I wasn't that clever. You know, wasn't that academically clever to be able to sit down and understand the molecular structure of things and all that type of stuff and really deep dive into the technology that was needed in order for you to get those qualifications. I took the next step was to have some kind of aspiration of being moving into science again and naively took a job at the Ministry of Education and Science at the age of 16. And that's why I didn't become the Prime Minister. because that really was an eye-opener of the civil service. And I think that, to make a long story short, the next job I took was also in the statistics department. The men there in that statistics department were 35, 40 years old, and there's me at 16, 17, took a liking to me and said, look, this is not for you. You don't want to be sitting here doing, you know, cost accounting and all this type of stuff, and it's a profession, fair enough. You've got an aptitude for marketing and sales. We can see it. And so I took a job selling tape recorders for a company. To the disappointment of my father at the time, whom in that era had seen me staying on at school to the age of 16 and a half investing so much in me in doing GCSE O-levels and A-levels and all that stuff, saw it as a kind of a come-down. What did we waste our, what did we waste our time for? Why wasn't you out, you know, at the age of 15 bringing some income into the household? Now, of course, you've already become a salesman in the end, eventually. All you've done is become a salesman in the end. So you can imagine that, that kind of disappointment, really. Because, but to be fair to him at the time, it was, you know, it was... He felt that, you know, all okay, we'll invest. He saw it as an investment in supporting me for two more years to go through education. And so, in a way, he felt maybe a little let down until he sold a load of his shares in Amstrad a few years later.
Good, I was going to ask you whether he.
And then realised he was he made the right choice.
I have thought, actually, haven't got very much time, but maybe just one question.
Well, we've got a bit more time if
that's
you want.
It's up okay, to lovely.
I've got to 8:15, so yeah.
Right, lovely, okay. Yeah. Well, that's great. Thank you very much.
Obviously, no one could ever replace you on The Apprentice because you're fantastic to watch. But if you weren't doing it, who would you like to see replace you, or who do you think would be a good replacement for you?
Well, it's an interesting question you asked there, because yesterday they launched the 9th series, and that's the same question that was asked by a journalist from The Sun. And I asked him to self-answer the question, self-answer it himself. I mean, the thing is that when you've got a good product, which The Apprentice is, it gets imitated. You've had, loads of people try to simulate it, and it doesn't work. ITV tried it with Peter Jones on something called, I can't even remember the name of it, but and then someone else tried it with Duncan Ballantyne. Someone else has tried it with this woman, the beauty, they all fail. Then, of course, you speak to my friend Philip Green, and he says, of course, they asked me to do it, you know. Of course, they asked me, but I turned it down. And I said to him, no, Philip, you couldn't do it, because you haven't got the charisma to do it. And Branson was asked to do, by Fox Television in America, he was asked to do an equivalent of the Trump version in America, and that didn't do very well either, that bombed. And a few other people, there's the Caldwell, the mobile phone bloke who owns the mobile phone companies. He's done about three attempts at it, and another young fellow that's got some drinks companies, smoothies, he's had an attempt at it. They all foul. So the TV companies have kind of given up. So that's the question they asked me. Who are we going to find to replace you? And I said, well, that's your problem, not mine, really, you know, because I will do it until I don't want to do it anymore. You know, it's as simple as that.
Okay, the gentleman there. Yeah, there. Well, I'm afraid I will have to make that the last one in order that we can do all the...
Okay, good. So I can get away.
Yeah, so you can get away at your appointed moment.
Just a quick one. Bringing it back to people talking about internships and everything. I'm also originally an Ilford boy, and I used to work in the markets in Dagenham. And I think it's actually sad that a lot of people... turn away from markets. I think I learnt a lot seeing all the traders and everyone out there, the way they used to sell things and get on with it. What can we do to try and keep it going? Because all the big companies that are out there, it's very hard for all the market guys and everyone trying to push things through that way.
Yeah, I was approached by Hackney Borough recently to try to regenerate Hoxton Market, because that was once a famous market and is now... It's gone downhill, and I'm quite surprised about that, because I mean there are markets that are very fashionable, and I think they have to adapt with the product offering that they're making to get the kind of audience to go there to purchase. You know, if you look at Camden, for example, the Camden market, the kind of the tremendous array of stuff that is on sale there has created an interest. And I think the way to do it is you have to find a place where you can get the footfall of people that are interested in a different kind of array of merchandise. Having said that, of course, stuff is so cheap these days, if you think about it. I mean, we go back to this famous 50 years ago I keep talking about, where, you know, to buy yourself a piece of clothing was a kind of major event. a major event to actually invest, for a lady to invest in a dress, or to a man to invest in a suit or a jumper or something like that. It was, you know, nowadays you go in these places like Primark, whatever. If you think about it, it's disposable clothing. It's the cost that you're buying merchandise for is so cheap that they have changed their business model. Instead of having four seasons a year, spring, summer, autumn and winter, it's 52 seasons. They have pouring in every single week. And a young person can go in there and buy themselves an outfit to wear for Saturday night, if you like, which costs less than the first round of drinks they're going to have to buy. Yeah? And throw it away. And so your market trader, he's really being squeezed out by the fact that he doesn't have the economy of scale that someone like Primark has. Whereas, you know, they used to sell on their stalls shirts and jeans and T-shirts and things like that. What's the big deal? Why am I going to drag to a marketplace and go to buy a cheap bit of stuff? It's so cheap now in the major retailers.
Lord Sugar, that was fantastic. Thank you very much indeed.